Ladies and gentlemen, we demonstrate the depth and breadth of our security cooperation through regular exchanges between our armed forces and our coast guards, including in the areas of maritime security, counterterrorism, humanitarian assistance, and disaster relief. We collaborate to strengthen and seek new business links, to bolster our economic security, and to develop responses to economic coercion. We work together to promote and enhance the flow of environmentally sustainable investment and to explore cooperation on mineral resources development and climate and energy transition, amongst others. Indeed, we have made good progress since we signed our strategic partnership last year. Ultimately, our partnership finds its anchor in our common commitment to ensuring that this region keeps to the path of peace, builds resilience, remains focused on delivering dividends to our citizens and our communities. Beyond our bilateral horizon, we project the commitment in our continued adherence to ASEAN centrality, which we will have the opportunity to reaffirm at the special summit between ASEAN and Australia in Melbourne next week. Beyond the region, we project this commitment too in our partnership and active leadership on the international stage. We collaborate closely with Australia to strengthen international security and universal adherence to international humanitarian law. I salute Prime Minister Albanese's personal commitment to our vision of a world free of nuclear weapons. It is a commitment that is shared by all peoples of Southeast Asia, with those of Australia and the Pacific Island states. Through the treaties of Bangkok and Rarotonga, our two regions serve as pockets of freedom from these destructive weapons. Within the ambit of the ASEAN Regional Forum and the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, our two countries are champions of nuclear disarmament and advocates for nuclear risk reduction. In the context of emerging technologies such as autonomous weapon systems and of new frontiers such as outer space and cyberspace, there is much room for our two countries to work together. Our collaboration in the United Nations demonstrates the need to continue to build bridges and to forge consensus towards decisive multilateral solutions. We cannot allow geopolitics to paralyze global governance. Now more than ever, we need multilateralism to work. This is particularly important given the scope of global cooperation needed to address our most pressing vulnerability, one that threatens the very survival of our peoples, one that threatens our very future. I speak, of course, of climate change. My country accepts its part in our collective responsibility. My administration is committed to accelerating our just, affordable, sustainable, and inclusive energy transition towards carbon neutrality. The Philippines has the potential to be a net carbon sink, absorbing more carbon dioxide than we emit. Yet we are one of the most climate vulnerable countries in the world, ranking first in the 2023 World Risk Index. This glaring disproportion between our share of responsibility and our vulnerability reflects an injustice that must be corrected. Developed countries must do more, and they must do it now. Our past successes should inspire us to forge ahead in building the future to which we aspire. For the Philippines, we continue to see that future in our identity as Asians and as members of the Pacific family. Together with our Asian neighbors, and in that group I include Australia, we continue to work for a regional community that empowers all of our citizens. As Asians, we are committed to fulfilling our region's promise as a global engine of growth and in remaining true to our shared value of mutual respect, our shared desire to flourish through our diversity. As part of the Pacific, we carry in our very DNA the heritage of seafaring civilizations that span two oceans. This manifests in the high regard our cultures place on family, on community, and on the environment. In Australia, we see not only a strong democracy, but an indispensable part of our Pacific community, a permanent stakeholder in the future of Asia, and a reliable supporter of ASEAN centrality. In Australia, we see a natural partner in our efforts to defend, to preserve, to uphold our open, inclusive, and rules-based international order, to ensure that it remains governed by international law and informed by the principles of equity and justice. In Australia, we see a lifelong friend with whom we have endured joint sacrifices, reveled in our shared victories, and now pursue common aspirations. All this inspires confidence in the future of our strategic partnership. This confidence is shared not only by our two governments, but also by our two peoples. We see this in the face of the almost 35,000 Filipino students who choose Australian schools to pursue their respective endeavors, the fifth largest foreign student population in Australia. We see this too in the nearly 30,000 Australians who work and live with us and have chosen to call the Philippines their home. We see this more importantly in the spirit of bayanihan and mateship that defines our relationship. Our mateship brought Australians to Tacloban, my mother's hometown, to bring relief in the aftermath of Super Typhoon Haiyan in 2013. Our bayanihan brought closure and peace to the families of the gallant Australians that perished in the sinking of the Montevideo Maru in 1942. And it is the same spirit that now brings our sailors, our airmen and soldiers together, shoulder to shoulder, in defending our rights and in securing our common future. For when the Southern Cross met the Pearl of the Orient, a friendship blossomed, withstood the test of war, and flourished through the changes brought about by a world in flux. Looking ahead, I am confident that Filipinos and Australians will remain steadfast partners, unyielding and uncompromising in our shared values, and energized as we gird ourselves to work together in the spirit of bayanihan and of mateship. Thank you and mabuhay.
And that was President Marcos addressing the Australian Parliament. He did express delight to be in Canberra and to be addressing officials in the Australian Parliament. The president did say that security of Australia is bonded with the security of the Philippines. And he did emphasize the importance of building strategies between the citizens and governments of Australia and the Philippines, as well as join forces with partnership to face the threats to the rule of law, of those who face the threats of the rule of law, rather. He also did say that we must come together to face the challenges facing the region, and to be strategic partners, that we must be stronger to protect the peace. The president also thanked Australian Prime Minister for uplifting the Philippines and being their partner. And he did say that the president sees a lifelong friend with the country of Australia. Filipinos and Australians, he did say that we will steadfast as being partners and working for peace. And that was earlier President Marcos addressing the Australian Parliament. I'm Bettina Magsaysay. Head Start comes your way next. Stay with ANC.